Hello, I'm Marianne Krasny, and I'm a professor in the Department of Natural Resources at Cornell University. Today, I'm going to talk briefly about climate change as an environmental issue, or what we call a wicked problem. And then I'm going to share with you some of my own thinking about how environmental education can help address climate change. We all know there are no easy answers, but there are some promising environmental education programs out there that we might learn from. The year 2015 continued, or should I say accelerated, a trend toward higher average global temperatures. Not only was it the warmest year since scientists began measuring global temperature averages, it was the first year that temperatures exceeded the average from the 1880s by more than 1 degree Celsius. I live in Ithaca, New York, about 200 miles inland from the Atlantic Ocean. For me, warmer temperatures so far have meant fewer opportunities for skiing and a longer growing season. No, yeah, once when I was on the bus, we had to take a detour to avoid flooded roads. If I were living in Bangladesh, the issue of climate change would be something totally different. I'm going to read from a 2014 article in the New York Times entitled "Borrowed Time on Disappearing Land." Dikope, Bangladesh. When a powerful storm destroyed her riverside home in 2009, Jahanara Khatun lost more than the modest roof over her head. In the aftermath, her husband died, and she became so destitute that she sold her son and her daughter into bonded servitude. And she may lose yet more. Miss Khatun now lives in a bamboo shack that sits below sea level, about 50 yards from a sagging berm. She spends her days collecting cow dung for fuel and struggling to grow vegetables in soil poisoned by salt water. Climate scientists predict that this area will be inundated as sea levels rise and storm surges increase, and a cyclone or another disaster could easily wipe away her rebuilt life. So the Times article continues. Bangladesh relies almost entirely on groundwater for drinking supplies because the rivers are so polluted. The resultant pumping causes the land to settle. So as sea levels are rising, Bangladesh's cities are actually sinking, increasing the risks of flooding. Poorly constructed seawalls compound the problem. So from these two vastly different experiences, my own experience in the US and Jahanara Khatun's in Bangladesh, we can come to see a few aspects of climate change that make it so complicated, or a wicked problem. First and most obvious is the difference in vulnerabilities between a rich country like the US and a poor, low-lying country like Bangladesh. Even though I emit tons more carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases than Miss Khatun, I, at least for the short term, am less vulnerable to climate change. Hence, one aspect of climate change as a wicked problem is global inequities. Second, we can see that in Bangladesh, not only is there the issue of houses being inundated by floodwaters, but surface water pollution has led people to have to pump from the groundwater, causing the land to subside and cities to sink and become even more vulnerable. Well, undoubtedly, you could find more facets to climate change as a wicked problem, but let's stop here for the sake of time. Climate change is perhaps the most wicked or intractable problem that we face. So just as people have said, it takes a village to raise a child, it takes all different kinds of ideas and expertise to address a wicked problem, like climate change. My particular expertise is environmental education, so I spent time thinking about the role of environmental education in addressing climate change. One challenge is that environmental education has traditionally focused on reducing our environmental footprint, or mitigating our impacts on the environment. This might be fine in Ithaca, New York, but in Bangladesh, we need to think immediately about adaptation. For example, given sea levels rising, how do we ensure that schools won't be flooded and that children are safe? Some efforts, like building seawalls, help communities to adapt to rising sea levels, at least in the short term. But they don't enhance our environment. For example, building a seawall might destroy a mangrove swamp that provided habitat for fish. However, there are efforts to adapt to rising sea levels that do enhance environmental quality. So for example, in the estuary surrounding New York City, school children and volunteers are building artificial oyster reefs, and they're seeding the oyster reefs with young oysters. Now, oyster reefs help protect the shoreline and increase oyster populations. And oysters are important filter feeders. They've been called the liver of the estuary because they help to filter contaminants from the water. By protecting the shoreline and creating habitat for an important species, oyster restoration both helps communities adapt to sea level rise and improves the environment. Although restoring oyster reefs may not sound like environmental education, the school children and volunteers engaged in the oyster projects have plenty of opportunities to learn. They learn about oyster biology and the ecosystem service of water filtration, as well as about how to work together towards a common goal. In this way, oyster restoration and hundreds of similar practices like replanting mangroves provide ample opportunities for environmental learning. I believe that climate change is the most important threat facing humanity. While action at the national and international levels is critical, environmental education acts locally, helping make communities safer and helping to improve the environment. And hopefully building the grassroots momentum to affect change at larger scales.